إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حتى أتاه اليقين فجزاه الله عنا خير ما جزى نبيا عن أمته ورسولا عن قومه اللهم احشرنا في زمرته وأوردنا حوضه اللهم لا تحرمنا شفاعته اللهم كما آمنا به ولم نره فلا تفرق بيننا وبينه حتى تدخلنا مدخله ثم أما بعد عباد الله فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي رسول الله وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار عياذا بالله وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون ولا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم أولئك هم الفاسقون أيها المؤمنون نتذاكر اليوم خبر فتى من فتيان هذا الدين العظيم نتذاكر خبر فتى غض طري نظر ذكي نشأ في بيئة مترفة وترعرع بين أسرة ثرية جمعت المال والشرف فكان أبوه سيداً عظيماً من سادات موطنه نشأ في ذلك وهو ابن السيد الغني الذي يمتلك ضيعة تدر عليهم من المال الوفير ما جعل حياتهم رغدة هنية تختلف عن حياة كثير من البشر ثم إنه كان له باع في الدين أيضا فقد كان أهله يعبدون النار وكان ذلكم الفتى يترقى في مدارج ذلك الدين حتى صار دهقان النار إلههم المزعوم فقد أوكل إليه أن تبقى النار مضرمة طوال الليل والنهار يبقى حارسها ولا يغيب عنها وكان ذلك شرفا عظيما في أبناء تلك الملة ولكنه ما إن تفتحت عيناه على دين الله وعلى الإله الحق حتى لفظ ذلك الهراء وذلك الدين الباطل الذي لا يأتيه خير من بين يديه ولا من خلفه وعلم أن ما نشأ فيه ولم يكن يعلم غيره على وجه الأرض علم أن ذلك باطل حق وأنه غباء محض أن يعبد الإنسان نارا يضرمها بيده ويعتني بها فمن هو ذلك الفتى الذي بحث عن الحق حتى وجده وعانى حتى عرف ما يصبو إليه وكافح وجاهد طوال حياته إلى أن وجد بغيته نسأل الله عز وجل أن يجمعنا به في الفردوس الأعلى مع نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. Today we're going to look at the story of one of the great people of this religion, one of the heroes of Islam, a young man who was raised up in a very wealthy family, and his father had a very high status in his people, not just because of his wealth, but he was from a noble family according to their understanding. He had a very big garden that produced a lot of fruits and generated a lot of wealth to that family. And that boy was very beloved by his family, to the extent that his father kept him at home like girls and did not allow him to mix with others, because he was so worried about him. And he started to teach him their religion. They used to worship fire in a town called Asbahan, which is between Tehran and another city in Iran. It's between Tehran and Shiraz in Iran today. He's a Persian young man in that noble family, very wealthy, and he was highly educated. In his religion, he became the guardian of the fire, their god. And he was given the duty to make sure the fire is always up, day and night, to make sure that it never goes out. And one day, that young man, who never heard about any other way of life, he thought that the entire earth was doing what he was doing. And one day his father said to him, "I'm busy today. I want you to go to our garden just to check that everything is okay." Early morning he left. On the way there, he heard something that he never heard before. In an old building, he went inside and he found some people reciting certain things. He liked it, and he asked them, "What were they doing?" They said, "We are praying." And after a few questions, he got to know those people were Christians. And he stayed with them for the whole day. He went back at sunset time to his father, who asked about the garden. He said, "I'm sorry, I didn't go there. I found people on my way worshipping God, the creator of us and the creator of this universe. And I found their religion much better and made much more sense than ours." The father got very angry and he said, "My son, there is no good in what you saw today." He said, "No, it is all good. There is no sense in what you do." And he said, "No, after today you're not going to leave." He chained him up in the house and he said to him, "Salman, you're not allowed out." Salman managed to meet people from that church and he said to them, "Please let me know when anyone is going to Syria from here." Because they did tell him that the origin of this faith is in Syria. After some time, they came to him and said, "There is a caravan leaving early morning, going to Syria." He managed to escape, he joined the caravan, and he traveled all the way to Syria. He went to a land that was so strange to him, to meet people who spoke different language, different culture, different faith, leaving behind all the luxury of his wealthy father. Why? Because he found the reality. He knew once he saw the truth that our way of life is not right. Worshipping fire is not the thing that we are created for. He went all the way. He made all the sacrifice to go there. And when he arrived, he asked about someone that is very knowledgeable about Christianity. He was taken to the vicar of that land. He went there and he said to the man, "I want to convert to Christianity and I would like to stay with you, to learn from you and worship God with you." And we can imagine how difficult was it just to explain these few words to someone of a very different language. A young man is going there to explain himself to someone. He was accepted and he stayed in the church. And he said, Salman himself, he said, it wasn't long until I realized that man was so evil. He was encouraging people to pay charity, to donate. And he was actually stucking that away for himself, giving nothing to the poor and needy. And people, because of their good intentions, they were giving and giving and giving. Until a time came when that man was departing this life, was dying. And he did die. And the people came to do the normal rituals with a priest. And he stopped them. He said, "Hold on, this man was so evil. He was encouraging you to donate and he was taking the money away for himself." He said, "What's the evidence?" He said, "Come, I'll show you." He took them somewhere when the man hid his treasure and they found seven big jars full of gold and silver. They crucified the man and stoned him. They appointed another one. Salman said, "I very quickly realized the new man was a man of God. Was man who was very pious and really devoted to his religion." He taught Salman, before rituals, he taught him manners. And he taught him the faith. He made him know Allah even better. Because imagine when he left his land to arrive there, he didn't know anything. And that new priest taught him exactly how to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship him. And after a few years, that priest was so ill and was about to die in a place that is Damascus today. And Salman said to him, "I'm lost after you. I haven't seen anyone around us that's like you. Where shall I go now?" And again, think about this man who made that big sacrifice. He had learned enough already to keep him going. He could have said, "I'm all right now, let me settle here, get married and start a business and live like anyone else." But his eager to learn more about his faith, to worship Allah in the correct way, made him ask this question. And the man said to him, "Unfortunately, there is no one around us like me. What you need to do, you need to travel to Al-Mawsil, which is in Iraq. Go to Al-Mawsil, and you will find a person." He gave him the name. "Go there and stay with him." When the man died, Salman took his luggage and traveled far in Iraq. That's in a place that is not far from Baghdad today. And he stayed with that man and he said, "I found him exactly like the other companion before him. I learned so much from him and stayed with him. My faith increased until the sad time arrived again." And this was another point of Salman to say, "Enough is enough. I need now to rest. I've been traveling for many years now. I need to start my own life." But Salman came to the man and he said to him, "What shall I do after you?" He said, "My son, the reality is, unfortunately, there is no one around us on this faith. All these people changed. There's only one man I know. He's following the same religion of Isa alayhi salam. He's in a town called Nasibin. And Nasibin is between Iraq and Syria. 6 days of travel from Al-Mawsil." He took his stuff after the man had passed away and he started to travel again to Nasibin. Again, another land, another people, to meet someone new and start again with that person. And he said, I arrived there to find a man as good as the previous two companions. I was with him. I learned from him a lot. Until another sad time arrived and the man was on the deathbed. I said to him, what to tell me? How to advise me? What to do after you? I've been traveling for long. He said to him, my son, there is only one person left on the surface of this globe that worships Allah following the footsteps of Jesus. This man in a town called Amuria. Go there after my death and join him. He left his family to Syria. From Syria, he went to Al-Mawsil, second travel, second migration. And from Al-Mawsil, he went to Nasibin. And now Nasibin, he's told to travel again for the fourth time to Amuria. He stayed with another person for a few years, and again the person was about to die. And same conversation took place. And he said to him, my son, the sad reality is I am the last person on earth who worships Allah according to the religion of Isa. All others are corrupt. They all changed. There is no one after me. I'm the last person. And that was a very critical moment for Salman to say, I've done my bit. I already have my excuse before Allah. When I see him, I'll explain to him. I tried my best and now this man's leaving. But the man said something interesting. He said to him, but according to what I know, the last prophet is about to appear. He's going to migrate from his hometown to a land of a lot of palm trees and lava stones. This man does not eat from charity, and he eats from the gifts, and between his shoulders is the mark of prophethood. And the man died. Salman said, while I was there in Amuria, I did some trade and I worked and I had some cows and sheep. And I met some Arabs from a tribe called Kalb. And those Arabs were traveling back from Syria to Arabian Peninsula. He said to them, take me with you and I'll give you my cows and sheep. He gave them all what he had. Said, take everything, but what I want from you, take me to your land. Now he's traveling to a completely different land, with a completely different culture, a land of no civilization, a land of another language and other customs. That was another huge sacrifice. Why? To find the truth. Because this young man realized we are individually responsible to find the truth and follow it. They took him on the way when they arrived at a place called Wadi al-Qura, somewhere north of Medina today. They betrayed him. They sold him as a slave. They took his cows and sheep and sold him in the slave market. Salman, the wealthy, the spoiled boy, is now a slave. And he was bought by a Jewish businessman there who started to use him in the normal slavery, in the normal work. And that Jewish person gave Salman. He sold him, or he gifted him to his cousin who was from Yathrib. I hope you are following. If you look at the map, he traveled from Persia to Syria, back to Iraq, Syria, until south of Syria and Amuria, and now he's coming to Arabia. And now he's taken to Yathrib, which is called Al-Madinah today, to work for that Jewish farmer in Yathrib, from Bani Qurayza, a Jewish tribe that used to live in Yathrib. Once he arrived, he said, Alhamdulillah, this is the land I'm after. He was taken as a slave to that particular land. He saw the palm trees and he saw the lava stone surrounding the city, and he said, this is exactly the land that was described by the last priest. And he started to work as a slave. So he was doing the normal work, morning till evening. And because farmers there, most of them had palm trees, he used to work on the palm trees. That was his job. He used to climb up and do all the work there, and so on. Until after one day, after some time, one day he was up on the tree, and his master was sitting under that tree with another person. And the other person was saying to him, to Salman's master, may Allah curse Arabs. They are gathering now around that man who claimed to be the prophet. Hearing that, Salman started to shake. What? He descends very quickly and he said to his master and the other man, can you repeat that? What did you say? I want to hear it again. And he got a strong punch in his face. Shut up. It's none of your business. Go back to your work. Salman started to search. By the end of that day, that very day, he took a plate of dates he collected and he went to find that prophet. He found Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sitting with his companions just a short while after their arrival. And he said to him, I heard that you traveled from another town to here with your companions, and I've got some dates that I wanted to donate as a charity, and I believe you deserve them more than anyone else. This is for you. فَأَمْسَكَ الرَّسُولُ يَدَهَا. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam pulled his hand back and he said to his companions, Bismillah, eat. Salman said, tick. This is the first sign. Because the man said to him, he does not eat from charity. So the Salman said, this is the first sign. Then later, he came with another plate of dates in front of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, I did realize you did not eat from the charity. This is a gift. I would like to gift you. You look like a righteous man. With your people, you can eat from it. Then Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Bismillah, let's eat. And he started to eat. And Salman said, this is the second one. And he was waiting for the third sign of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But how could he see the back of a Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How could he expose between the shoulders of a Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and see the prophethood mark? He heard one day that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is burying one of his companions in Al-Baqiyah. If you go to Medina, next to Al-Haram, there is a cemetery there. That graveyard is the same one where Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to bury his companions. So he heard that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was burying someone there. He said, that might be a chance. Let me go and see. He went there and the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two thick scarves on his back. He greeted the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and then he turned around and he was looking. He was trying to see something. And the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam did see that. He dropped the scarves for Salman to see the mark between the shoulders of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Salman couldn't stop himself. He hugged the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and started to kiss him from his back and his shoulders. And he turned around kissing Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and crying, I found you. I found you. And the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ma sha'nuk? What's your story? Then he told the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam about his story. Since he left his family until he became in front of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam called his companions and he said to them, come and listen. And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لو كان الحق في الثريا لتناوله رجال أمثال هذا. لتناوله رجال أمثال هذا. He said, if the truth was in the sky with the stars, it will be taken by people like this one. This is Salman Al-Farsi, the Persian companion of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This man stayed with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam until he died, learning from him and following his footsteps. Once he was sitting with other people, all Arabs, and they were introducing themselves. So this one said, I'm from Quraysh. Other one said, I'm from that tribe, I'm from this tribe, I'm from this tribe. And Arabs are very proud of their tribes and their identities. It came to Salman, and he said, أبي الإسلام لا أبا لي سواه إذا افتخروا بقيس أو تميم. He said, my father is an Islam. I have no father but him when other people are proud of their tribes and nations. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Salman minna al bayt. Salman is one of us, the dwellers of the house. He's like saying, Salman is from my own family. Salman, the one who spent all his life searching for the truth, to find the truth and to learn, until he found the absolute truth with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, what did Salman do? He left Medina. Why? Why did he leave Medina after the death of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The prayer there is multiplied. The grave of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is right next to him. All the good memories are there. He left it because he had a duty. As he searched for the truth and found it, he had the duty to deliver that truth, to spread it to others. He left Al-Madinah and he died where he was born. He traveled all the way to spread the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to convey what Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him. So he spent his younghood searching for the truth, and he spent his last years spreading the truth. A role model, a hero, an example for us to learn from. These are the companions that were selected by Allah to be around Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For that generation to be the generation of light and the generation of inspiration, and the generation to be followed in order to be with them on the Day of Judgment. My brothers, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow His mercy on Salman on the day he died and on the day he will be resurrected. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us here in this particular place, to gather us with Salman al-Farsi radiallahu anhu, with our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to be their companions as we are deprived from being with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions in this life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of our love to them, to gather us with them on the Day of Judgment and in the highest rank of Al-Jannah. Allahumma inna nas'aluka ridaka wal-Jannah wa na'udhu bika min sakhatika wa min al-Nar. Allahumma inna nas'aluka hubbaka wa hubba man yuhibbuka wa hubba kulli amalin yuqarribuna ila hubbuk. Allahumma inna nas'aluka bi kulli ismin huwa lak, sammayta bihi nafsak أو أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا وشفاء صدورنا وذهاب همومنا وغمومنا. اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وأطراف النهار على الوجه الذي يرضيك عنا. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن الذين ينعمون بصحبته آناء الليل وأطراف النهار. اللهم واجعلنا من أهل القرآن الذين ينشرونه بين الناس. اللهم مكن لهذا الكتاب العظيم في الأرض وافتح له قلوب الخلق برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وارض اللهم عن أصحابه الغر الميامين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وسلمان الفارسي، وعن الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وعنا معهم بعفوك ومنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، وأقم الصلاة.